star. Might win an Oscar, you can never tell. The movie's gonna make me a big star.
Hello and welcome to Meet Me at the Movies. I am Noel T. Manning II. Appreciate you being here. Thanks for tuning in right here at C19 TV from the campus of Cleveland Community College. We talk movies every single week right here when we can, and when Mr. Remington Steele over there beside camera one
will
allow us. Remington Steele, good to see you, man.
I wish.
Welcome.
Oh,
welcome.
It's good to be here. Does anyone remember Remington Steele? That's a 35-year-old reference.
It is, yeah. but a lot of our references are even older. So
that's true. So, that's true. We skew toward that demo.
Remington Steele became James Bond. Ultimately,
yeah, that's true. Yeah. And not a bad one either.
Not in a bad way. Yeah. That's Greg Tillman. Greg Tillman beside camera one. Special guest, Casey Delehanty. That's a name that's really Dr. Casey Delehanty. It's a name that I love to say, and I say it with every kind of accent I can. Take Casey Delehanty. You know.
What else you got?
I will say I'm not super particular about pronunciation because we looked back into it and found it was one of those Ellis Island names of like. Oh, that's too complicated. You're this now. So given that there's no, coat of arms or anything, I'm not too particular about pronunciation.
So how do you
Delehanty?
Delehanty.
Yeah.
Delehanty. Okay. I'm probably going to do it some other way.
It's okay.
Do it differently every time.
Every time. Every time.
Give the audience an option.
It's absolutely.
A multiple choice.
Well, Dr. Delehanty?
Oh, boy. It's going to be a long show.
It's going to be talking to us today about torture in film, which we're going to get to a little bit later, which is kind of an odd topic for us. Normally, we have a lot more fun, and not that
we're tortured by films.
Yes, tortured by film at times, absolutely. But there's a great research project that you were involved in with a co-author. We're going to talk about that as well, and kind of get into the essence of why that happened, and are there sequels involved in what you're going to be doing down the road with this project. But before we dive into any of that, we would be in trouble if we didn't go to the number one person who gets fan mail here. That's Tim, back here on the Tim Cam. Tim, good to see you. I know you've got a special guest. Yeah, that's our mascot. That's Elvis Gnomesley. Elvis Gnomesley. He's nice. I like him. Good job.
Where did you get that thing?
A fan. That was viewer mail. That was viewer mail. Not non-viewer mail, but it was actually viewer mail that sent that in. So I had to get it scanned to make sure there was nothing in there that was going to explode. And when they said, I don't know what it is, but I don't think it's going to hurt you. So there you go. So enjoy.
He seems to have bonded with it in an unusual way.
Well, he always talks about being lonely back there. And so now
it's talking to him now. Tim's ready for his summer vacation, I think.
We are in trouble. Well, Casey, thanks for being here. Really appreciate it. Appreciate you talking to us about this project. You and I have talked a little bit about it before. But before we dive into it, let's talk about your love of film, if you have a love for film, and a little background on what you kind of grew up watching and what you're drawn to now.
Oh, goodness. Absolutely. So I've always been a big movie person. I have a theory that a lot of my life was shaped by the movies Toys and Surf Ninjas, which were my two favorite really weird movies when I was growing up.
Surf Ninjas?
Oh, yeah. Surf Ninjas.
I missed that one.
Oh, it's a classic. I think we can undoubtedly say classic. Rob Schneider, peak of his game.
Well, you say more.
Exactly.
It doesn't get any better than Rob Schneider in film.
So I've always really, really loved movies. My tastes are really all over the map.
Yeah, apparently.
When it comes to movies, as you can see. My favorite ever is probably also a weird one. White Men Can't Jump is my. I love that movie.
Wesley Snipes.
Yes. Rosie Perez. Right?
Yeah.
Fabulous. Yeah.
Woody Harrelson. Can't forget Woody Harrelson.
It holds up a lot better than you would think it does.
Okay.
As a person who still regularly watches it. I especially really enjoy sci-fi movies. As well as a political scientist, I think sci-fi movies are really great because they will address some sort of extant, really important social or political issues, but they'll do it in a way that allow us to think about them more naturally without all the baggage that we normally bring to it.
Right, right.
So Captain America Civil War, as we talked about, is actually a really good example of this because it's a movie that's entirely about international institutions and international law, and to what degree should superpowers sort of hold themselves back, right?
And not superhuman powers, but...
Right. It's Captain America is very, very strictly a stand-in for America, right?
Right.
And so what responsibility do they have to sort of hold themselves to the rules that the rest of the world sort of puts upon them? And I really love having that conversation about that topic in the context of, you know, let's talk about superheroes. Who's right? Is it Iron Man or Captain America? Because then we can have the conversation about international institutions without it being sort of all the baggage of the United Nations and everything we sort of think alongside that. So.
Yeah. So how do your students engage in that? I mean, do they engage in it a different way than they would if you were actually talking about the international relations of what's happening within the world?
I found they really love talking about these issues through movies because for a lot of them, it's their first sort of experience at critical analysis of film.
Okay.
We tend to watch movies and then say like, oh great, that was fun. But without necessarily sitting there and thinking hard about like, okay, what does this mean? And what's trying to be said here? Mm-hmm. One of the big insights I think I always had about movies is in a good movie, nothing's unintentional in the sense that every single piece here, this was somebody's very strict job. Right. And they had something they wanted to convey even to that ottoman in the background of the scene, right? Like, there was a person who decided, of all these various ottomans, this ottoman tells our story the best, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so...
Greg's looking for our guest back there, but he's
who I saw the other night in Warden, and he was going to be on this week, or last week.
But you're right. I mean, even the props, which the production designer is heavily involved in putting that together, I mean, they are... Their job is to take the vision of the director and pull that into everything that you're seeing that's not a costume and that's not
there's
the
a reason for everything
there's
in
a
the
reason.
Shot.
Absolutely. Right. And in some films, the deeper you get in those layers and the more you pay attention to that, it really does speak volumes.
Right. And yeah, it's interesting to sit and think very seriously about and sort of pick apart. Pick apart film, although through the course of this project I found that some films are not really meant to be thought of that hard sometimes.
Are we going back to surf Nazis or whatever it was called?
Well, you have any questions for him before we dive
into
it?
I'm an observer.
Okay. Yeah. Well, let's talk about this project. The name of the project is?
Wait, There's Torture in Zootopia, Examining the Prevalence of Torture in Popular Movies.
And we don't have a graphic long enough to put all that in there, so you'll just have to take Casey's word for that. And so Zootopia is in the title.
Yes.
So we'll get to Zootopia, but the project was looking at the top 200 films, well, top 20 films over the course of 10 years.
Yes.
And box office films.
Right.
And examining elements of torture that show up. That's the simple version of it.
Yeah, so essentially I've been perplexed for a while about the depth of public opinion support for government torture policy, right? Like around, and it's pretty, depending on how you ask the question, about half of Americans believe that like the government should be able to torture people in at least some cases, in some circumstances. And that's always been very interesting to me because it doesn't, that's, you know, a human rights violation generally against democratic values, and B, most experts on the topic will tell you it's not very effective. So why do we engage in this thing that's bad and that most people will tell us don't work? Well, maybe it's because we have sort of a mistaken idea about it. And I got around to this idea, time and again we see torture happen in film, and anecdotally going into the project, I was like, and it always feels like it's successful in the sense that especially when an antagonist is tortured, it feels like they tend to give up the information, but our protagonists, you know, they give their name and
rank and serial number,
as you say, right? So we really dove into the project trying to figure out what do movies tell us, how do movies condition us to feel about torture and condition our expectations on that, and how might that feed into our opinions on policy, right? It's an indirect and interesting way, we thought, at least into how movies shape our world
right.
in a real
right.
way.
Now, you mentioned We and Us, so you co-authored this.
Yes.
Now, talk about your co-author.
Yes. So my co-author, Erin Carnes, is at the University of Alabama. She's a criminologist over there and absolutely fabulous. I'm humbled that she chose to work with me on this and does really, really fantastic work on especially terrorism and also torture in media.
Now, the idea for pursuing this actually came not from the medium of film, but another medium.
So along with films, I also enjoy video games from time to time. It's a really good sort of release at the end of the day. And there was a Batman video game that I really enjoyed. It was really, really fun. And part of the context of playing it, one of the missions that you had was you had to go find these little trophies that the villain, the Riddler, had hidden all over Gotham, and you got to go find the trophy and solve a little puzzle and do the thing. But key to that was that you had to find one of the Riddler's goons and like beat out the information of where the Riddler trophy was. And because it was the last thing I had sort of saved to do in the game, I found myself just driving around Gotham just torturing goons
just to get the information.
Just to get, because I got to find the trophies.
Okay.
And it really, I had to pause it and eventually stop playing the game out of this moment of self-reflection of like, what is this? What am I doing? Right? Like, this is not the Batman I wanted to be. And really get to this idea of, you know.
You're more like the Adam West Batman, you know?
Right. Because it was never unsuccessful. There was never time when the goon didn't have the information or where they gave me the wrong information. I'd never faced any consequences or anything like that. And I really got to this idea of, like, what happens when we so consistently see depicted consequence-free, effective torture? Right?
Wow.
And how does that affect our perceptions of how that would work in the world? So the late Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia actually cited positively twice the show 24 as a defense of, well, I mean, you know, we couldn't convict Jack Bauer for doing what he needed to do to save the city of Los Angeles or whatever. So
this fictional thing is being utilized as thinking about policy.
Right, exactly. And so we really jumped into this project first trying to get a sense of when we talk about torture in media, we typically only talk about Zero Dark 30 or 24 or something like that, but that's not what most of us watch, right?
Right.
Like, Zero Dark 30 does not actually make our sample because I think Zero Dark 30 is like the 35th most popular film in its year, right? Like, it's not a thing that most of us watch.
So why did you decide on the top 20?
It's kind of arbitrary,
to be honest,
right? Like, it's one of those that 10 didn't feel like enough.
Right.
Anything more than 20 would have driven me insane.
Yeah, so you did 200 films,
right,
though.
Right. So we watched 200 films in total from 2008 to 2017, the top 20 movies by box office every single year.
You had a question.
Question, how do you define torture? I mean, what Mo does to Shemp and Curly, does that count, or what are the parameters?
So this was actually a thing that ended up being so much more complicated than you would have thought, in part because movies deal in alternate realities where people have superpowers or these other histories and things like that. And in the paper we have a nice strict write-up that we initially began with the UN definition. But the simplest way I can sort of phrase it is intentional pain, either psychological or physical, that is intentionally imparted on a person who cannot voluntarily remove themselves from the situation and is not threatening the torturer or anybody else, right? Like, you're not trying to sort of disarm someone, right? Like, this is somebody who can't remove themselves from the situation and also isn't sort of threatening them. There's a scene from the first Guardians of the Galaxy movie that's actually kind of instructive on this.
Okay.
So, is it the first one?
Actually, I think in every Guardians of the Galaxy, there, and even when you see these characters show up in the later films in Infinity War and also Endgame, torture is involved.
Oh, yes, very much so.
Especially with one particular character.
Yes. I was particularly glad I didn't have to code Infinity War because movie is chock full of torture scenes. But yeah, I believe it's the first Guardians of the Galaxy movie where they sort of take our heroes into prison, and one of the prison guards has Peter Quill's Walkman. And so Quill sort of tries to rush at him to go get it, and the guard sort of hits him with a stun gun. And that's okay. Quill's rushing at him. He's a prisoner. He's a prison guard. That's totally understandable. You have to sort of disable this person who's posing a threat. And then he hits him again once he's like at his knees, and you're like, okay, it's maybe questionable. It's maybe above board. The scene ends with him shocking Quill, who is now completely incapacitated, right, and is down the slide, just shocking him until the scene cuts, just to impart pain as punishment for having done this. And that's when we sort of tick the line into torture, right? Like, okay, he's not posing a threat,
right,
and he can't remove himself from the situation because he's sort of been pinned down at this point. Exactly.
Okay. So. Well, we're going to take a quick break. We're going to be right back with more right here talking about torture in film and an incredible research project that explored over 200 films over the course of 10 years. Right here on Meet Me at the Movies, C19 TV. Tim, you still back there, buddy? Yeah, Elvis, is Elvis still back there? All right, good deal. Elvis is still back there as well. And Mr. Tillman, he's still awake, so there's some good things happening this week, which is not normally the case. So, hey, I guess when you got something good, we'll just keep bringing Casey back. So if it keeps Greg awake, we're good for that. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Yeah, see, Zach never kept me awake. So.
Jackie Sibley Newton, the host of Experience Cleveland County on C19 TV, on Spectrum Cable, and also online at c19.tv. This is a show all about community partners, organizations, and businesses coming together to make this a better community to live, work, and play. So watch us every other week on C19 TV.
Chef Paul Prudhomme once said, "You don't need a silver fork to eat good food." Well, on Cleveland County Kitchen, we don't have a silver fork, but we sure do serve up lots of good food. Hi, I'm Deborah Blanton. I hope you'll join me for the next Cleveland County Kitchen. Each month, we offer a complete farm-to-table experience. We visit local growers, we learn about nutrition, and wrap things up with wonderful meals prepared by our guest chefs. It's a lot of fun. I hope you'll join me for the next Cleveland County Kitchen.
They're gonna put me in the movies. They're gonna make a big star out of me.
Welcome back to Meet Me in the Movies. I'm Noel T. Manning II, joined by Tim back there on the Tim Cam. Tim Foster, keeping things in order. Appreciate you as always. The guy really, does he work out like between shows? Is that what he does?
Does that count eating sandwiches? I don't know.
Yeah, he does that. Yeah. He does that and drinking water. He drinks water. Good, clear water. Yeah. Good job. Got that from Lake Hollifield there on the campus over there.
Yeah, is that good drinking water?
Well, it can be. You have to see
if you're a duck.
Good filters. Good filters. That's Greg Tillman, and we've got, who do we have over here?
Casey Delehanty.
There you go.
You just didn't want to say it, did you?
I didn't want to say it wrong because I'm just good at that. I'm just really good at that. I get, and we do get viewer mail.
Give it one more shot.
We do get viewer mail. Casey Delehanty.
Delehanty. Okay,
right. Yeah, that's Delehanty.
Delehanty. Yeah. See, that was good. Yeah. We do get viewer mail whenever I say a movie star's or a director's name wrong. So keep that.
Which
keep
is
that
good. Keeps us on
which
our toes.
Good. Yeah. Yeah, but, you know, I grew up in Eastern North Carolina. We never know how to say things correctly, so it's just the way it is. Just the way it is.
How do you say liver mush there? You don't, do
we
you?
Don't. We don't. We don't say liver mush there. Well, we are talking about, as I'm laughing, it feels weird to dive right back into this, but we're talking about torture in film, a research project that you did. It was a co-authored with someone from the University of Alabama.
Aaron Carnes.
Aaron Carnes from the University of Alabama. And you guys are going to do a sequel to this project that hopefully, or maybe, that we'll talk about before we wrap things up. But we're, you looked at 200 films, the top 20 films each year at the box office for a course of 10 years. So my math is correct. That's 200 films that you examined. And you examined movies that were family films all the way up to some R-rated films. So talk a little bit about that variance that you saw and the differences you saw between the kid films and those that were a little more adult films.
So yeah, as you say, our sort of criteria for inclusion was popularity and box office. So we really kind of ran the gamut ratings-wise. The most common rating in our sample is PG-13, but we had some R stuff, G and PG. And as you say, there's still a lot of torture in the kids' movies, as sort of noted by our paper title.
Yeah, give me the paper title one more time.
Wait, there's torture in Zootopia, which is actually one of my students' co-authors, one of my co-author's students.
Right.
Actually, that was her quote when we started, my co-author talked about this project in class. She said, wait, there's torture in Zootopia? Because it was her favorite movie and she just couldn't believe it.
What was the torture scene in Zootopia?
So they want to understand where the these berries that are making the animals act feral are coming from or how they're being sort of implanted. And they have to get the information from a weasel, naturally, called Duke Weaselton. And they take it to like a mafia boss possum, I think, as I remember.
And sounds terrifying.
Right.
Already it's terrifying. Yeah.
And the mafia boss, Possum, ends up having his polar bear goons. And I know, this is
polar bears are the meanest bears.
Sound when you really start thinking about them strictly. But they're polar bear goons, and they sort of, they dangle Duke Weaselton over sort of an icy, sort of like a ice fishing hole looking thing. Sort of a threat of death until they get him to sort of admit where the blueberries are coming from. And it's actually emblematic. A lot of the kids' movie torture scenes are very, very much like that, where they dangle someone off of something, or in Rio, there's a scene where I think it's like marmots or something. They take them up very, very high and drop them and just catch them right before they hit the ground so as to force them into some action. And so the kids' movies will have torture scenes that are not maybe as gruesome or as gory, but they're sort of torture scenes nonetheless in the sense that you are imparting real psychological horror, especially, so as to gather information or force somebody into one or another action.
Now, you talk about the psychological horror, but you examine not just physical torture, but psychological torture.
Yes, yes. So that's actually one of the interesting things that we'll see a lot. So the kids' movies tend to trend more towards that, where there's not necessarily violence imparted, but there's the threat of horrible violence or horrible death. There's also the threatening people's family members or doing something something that will impart some serious psychological pain to the victim, and is intentionally embarked upon to do just that. As a means to get them to do one or another thing.
Right. You had a question.
Well, the description from Zootopia on the surface sounds silly, but I guess basically it subconsciously can desensitize someone to torture and violence. Is that the potential danger?
Right. So we actually borrowed a bit from communications literature and communications theory to kind of inform our how we feel that this works. Essentially, it's when we don't have experience with an issue, we tend to lean on sort of shared experience to inform us as to our opinions or expectations on it, right? So like, you and I have opinions on taxes, and like, I can watch a movie about taxes, and it's probably not gonna change my opinion, because I have a lot of firsthand experience with taxes, right? Like, we all
taxes. Well, that's torture.
Torture. We all have a shared opinion on it, and you can't voluntarily remove yourself. So to that point, we're going to have opinions on things that we experience firsthand, right? And our opinions probably won't be very malleable on that. But when it's something I don't have any experience with, like It's what is it like to play for the South African rugby team? I don't know. I watched Invictus once. Like, maybe that helps inform me what that might be like, right? We lean on sort of pop culture through sort of the stories that people tell us to form our expectations about these things that we have just zero experience with. And our idea with this was, more and more, we are asked to address a policy question that, thankfully, most people have no direct firsthand experience with. So how do people form their opinions on how torture works in practice, given that they've thankfully never been either victim or perpetrator? Right. Well, we lean on movies, and movies seem to tell us, or at least actually we showed statistically, movies the vast majority of the time show torture as an effective way to get the thing that you want.
Interesting, really, really interesting. So going into this project, what were you hoping to gain from it? And now that you're on the backside of it, looking back, what did you gain?
So yeah, I'll say my expectations were pretty much kind of what I laid out earlier. My expectation was, just anecdotally, it felt like protagonists very rarely were sort of able to be successfully tortured, mm-hmm. because, as you say, they give you rank and serial number, right? Whereas antagonists might be more likely to do so, and I didn't have too many more opinions beyond that. But what we've done is we've really drilled down sort of statistically and systematically grading out. I mean, I think we ended up having, 38 different variables for every single scene.
Wow.
In which we coded the identity of the perpetrator and sort of the purpose of the attack and some of the situational elements and so on and so forth, that we can now sort of really have this systematic look at how is this act sort of portrayed in movies across the spectrum, and what are the lessons that are really being portrayed from that.
Tonight I have a burning desire suddenly to do a double feature between Zootopia and Saw. I don't know why. Seems right.
I was thinking about the Surf Ninjas or Surf Nazis. There's also a Surf Nazis as well.
Rob Schneider, Tone Loke, it's a classic.
Well, again, introduce your, let people know who you are.
Yes.
So, and how they can find you.
Yes, I'm Casey Delehanty. I am the Global Studies Director at Gardner-Webb University. Come on down, take my classes. CaseyDelehanty.com is my website, and I'm thinking right now I need to make sure that there's a draft of this on there when I go home. But yeah, you should be able to find a draft of this paper if you like.
Put a pronunciation key for your name, too.
Exactly.
Well, thanks for being here, and thanks for talking to us about this as well. Greg, any final thoughts, questions?
No, it's fascinating.
Yep. Tim, on the Tim Cam, we appreciate you as always, and thanks for having Elvis here joining us also. Elvis Nomsley there. Yep, appreciate that.
It'd be a shame if he disappeared.
He disappeared.
No, I meant Tim.
Email us info@c19.tv if you have questions, comments, and we'll make sure we get those to Casey over here as well. Quote of the week, we actually got the quote.
I don't say you screwed up last week.
I messed up last week.
You have two this week?
I've got one, but it's just as good. It's just as good as two.
It's doubly good.
This comes from John Shaft. Shaft.
I thought you were going to say Rudisel.
A new one. Yeah, so speaking of torture, he's going to be torturing some people. You know, you wouldn't know Egyptian cotton if the Pharaoh himself sent it to you. Comes from John Shaft. Till next time, I'm Noel T. Manning II for Meet Me at the Movies. Till next time, that's a wrap.